Hey, what's up? Alex here, finally back with a smart home video. The reason why I haven't been doing a smart home video for quite some time is because I've been planning to change my entire setup. After implementing some smart tech solutions in the house, you will realize that they operate in silos whereby these smart devices are not able to communicate together. For example, you can't set this Xiaomi motion sensor to switch on or off your Philips Hue light, or this Aqara Cube, which is like a wireless switch, to operate your switchboard. There are like 20 smart home apps in your phone and you don't have a single centralized solution or dashboard to manage and control these smart home devices. So in this video, I'm going to share 7 centralized smart home solutions that you should consider when you're planning for a smart home. This is like the step one that you should actually do. For each of those, I'm going to talk about how powerful is the solution, how hard it is to use, and my overall recommendation considering other pros and cons. I want to be upfront first and say I haven't had a chance to hands-on experience all of them. It's more like the information I researched and gathered since I'm also looking to take a step to the next level of my current setup. So if I give any wrong info to the solution that I'm currently using, please let me know in the comments below. This is the video I wish I would have when I started my smart home journey, especially coming from a local Singapore context. Let's go for it. Alright, I'm going to start with Google Home because this is what I've been using and what most of you are using as well here in Singapore. Take note that I'm not referring to the Google Voice Assistant, but just the Google Smart Home features. I'm giving them a 1.5 star rating because there are so many things that it couldn't do versus their competitors. After hooking up the devices into Google Home, there are many of them that doesn't allow you to control anything with it. No controls, not even on and off, which make me sometimes wonder why are they appearing here in the first place. But if you happen to have a Google Nest Hub, you will then see some controls there, which I totally don't get it, why it can be there but not on the app. You only have routines here, and the routines can basically only be triggered with voice commands, not from any smart home devices, not even sensors. How hard it is to use, I give it a 2 out of 5 star. The UI interface can be much better. Imagine if you have many devices, you have to keep scrolling and you can't swipe left or right to go to other rooms. Somehow, the ease of use is kind of because of its limited features and controls you have. If you use Google Calendar a lot or use a Google Pixel phone, then it has some nice integration features there. Google Home also has the widest range of compatible devices here in Singapore. I know I used to recommend Google Home a lot in this channel, but now it's tough with all these limitations. Plus, another reason is Amazon Alexa is now officially available here in Singapore. I'm not sure when this happens, but now the Amazon Alexa app is in the App Store. But not all of their services are available yet, like traffic and map direction. But it's okay, we're just going to look at the smart home features. How powerful is the solution? I'm giving it 3 out of 5 stars. You can set routines triggered with sensors, which is so useful, and you have controls to every devices. There is also an energy dashboard for you to see your device's energy consumption. Few things I hope they could add is being able to add more than one if condition, able to set more than one custom actions for every routines, and one more thing is having shortcuts or widgets on your mobile home screen. How hard it is to use, I'm giving it the same as Google Home, 2 out of 5 stars. Very straightforward, interface is actually pretty similar to Google. You have all these device type at the top, then you have your groups, which is the same thing as rooms below. From here, you can switch on or off everything in that particular room. Right now, some of the supported Amazon Alexa products are still not available in Singapore, like my Bose soundbar. But I'm sure things will start improving, so I would definitely recommend this if you are looking to keep your setup simple, or your configuration and voice assistants in the same app. Personally, I'm waiting for the second generation of the Echo Show 8 to be available, then switch my voice assistants from Google to Amazon. Especially I'm using the Ring doorbell, it's able to straight away give me a live video feed whenever someone presses the doorbell. The new Echo devices will all come with a built-in Zigbee hub, so as more products are natively integrated, it will then become like the cheapest and easiest all-in-one smart home solution. Next solution we're going to look at is the Apple HomeKit, which is actually a very powerful solution combining all the automation rules you can set and also with the use of Siri shortcuts. It has all the basic stuff you'll want like triggering from any of your smart home devices, including sensors. You can even apply a repeat loop to keep doing a certain task for X number of times, which means you can do things like making a smart bulb flash 3 times. It has also some very cool features like using a NFC tag to trigger scenes. If you are in the Apple ecosystem with the Apple Watch, you can control your smart home with it. And with their latest AirTags, you can set some very interesting automation with that as well. So in terms of functionality, I'm going to give the Apple HomeKit a 3.5 stars. One of the main selling points of Apple software is always how user-friendly it is. UI is very clean and simple. Comparing with all the solutions that I'm going to cover today, this is the easiest with just 1 star. So it seems like a solution that I would definitely recommend, but not quite so. First of all, it's only supported for iPhone users. For me, I actually started using iPhone since the 3GS days all the way to iPhone X. And yes, I'm one of those that always get the latest iPhone whenever it's launched. I also used to wear an Apple Watch, but now I'm pretty happy that I'm out of the Apple ecosystem. Okay, that's a separate topic altogether. Apple has the smallest range of compatible devices, and part of the reason why is because Apple emphasizes a lot in security. So it's harder for those small smart home companies to have their products certified by Apple and put inside their ecosystem. In other words, the products that work with Apple HomeKit are generally the bigger brands and they are more expensive. But well, if you're an Apple supporter, you probably don't care too much about the price. Another thing to concern is Apple's direction in the smart home world. Couple of months back, they discontinued their Apple HomePod, leaving just the HomePod Mini. So overall, I'm kind of like sitting on the fence for this one. Of course, if you're an Android phone user, you can totally forget about this option. But for iPhone users, going with the Apple HomeKit is a pretty good choice. Alright, next one is Xiaomi Mi Home app. I think many of you are using this as well because it's just so easy to get started with. I started off my smart home journey with some Aqara switches, their curtain motors, and a bunch of Xiaomi sensors which I purchased during my home renovation. At the time, I'm thinking just use the Mi Home app and expand my smart home from there. But after using like a couple of months, I switched to Google Home. So how good is the solution? I'm giving it a 3 out of 5 stars rating. You have a super long list of natively integrated devices. The automation rules you can set has the features you would typically want. You can also add other platform devices, but you will realize almost all of them are companies in China, which have no global presence. So that's not very relevant similarly to the long list of integrated devices. How hard to use? I give it a 2 out of 5 stars. Very similar to the Apple interface, but you can't directly control the devices from your dashboard. Another problem with using Mi Home is there is no inbuilt voice assistant. So if you want, you can only get their Xiaoai speaker, which is only in Chinese, and I don't think that it has other capabilities here in Singapore besides the smart home controls. And another huge issue that I always get so many questions about is the region setting. You have to set to Chinese mainland because most of the devices are not supported if you select Singapore. And because it is set to China, it means your controls will have to go all the way to China, then come back here to Singapore. So there is a noticeable latency, although the device is right in front of you. So overall, whether I would recommend using the Xiaomi Mi Home as your central smart home platform, the answer is no. After covering solutions from the 4 big companies that have their own AI voice assistants, the next 3 are going to be hub-based solution. A benefit of having hub-based solution as your central control is you have the flexibility to choose and switch to any voice assistants anytime, be it Google, Alexa, or Siri. I have switched my whole smart home setup to be under this guy, the Samsung SmartThings. This means that I can get rid of this Aqara and Xiaomi Zigbee hubs and have all my devices to consolidate in SmartThings. These are very simple hubs meant for just their own company or products. But the SmartThings or any hub-based centralized solutions has integration with many other brands. In terms of native integration, you can see a long list of brands here. Many of them are companies in the US and UK, but there are also many familiar international brands. What makes this hub powerful and different from this hub is the ability to write your own apps and device handler. So this opens up a whole new world of features that you can put in place. How powerful I rate this, I will give it 4 out of 5 stars. How hard it is to use, I will give 3.5 stars. If you are just connecting brands found in their list, then it's straightforward, like the previous solution I mentioned. But if the brand you are using is not here, like my Aqara products, then you need to go to their Groovy IDE using custom coding to do the integration. But you need not write coding yourself because there is a huge community of developers writing these codes. So basically, all you need to do is to import their codes to your own device. From the app itself, UI is very clean, easy access to your rooms, devices, scenes, and automation rules. For Windows PC users, you can even install the app from Microsoft Store, but note that it is still a work in progress, so don't expect everything to run perfectly. You can get this hub from Lazada or even from Singtel. They are bundling it with their broadband. The only concern from the smart home community is whether Samsung will start charging a subscription fee because right now, it's totally free after you purchase the hub. You know, keeping the servers running all this requires an operating cost. Nobody knows what's going to happen in the future, but for now, I would recommend the Samsung SmartThings. It is the one that I feel that is the most suitable for my current needs. Next popular hub-based solution is the Hubitat. Many people like to compare them with SmartThings, both can support the standard protocols, both can write your own custom apps and drivers, both can hook up with Google, Amazon or Apple for the voice assistant. The only difference is Hubitat runs locally without the need for internet. So in terms of performance and privacy, it's better, but I don't consider these points as something very critical. So how powerful is the solution? I give it 4 out of 5 stars. In terms of how hard it is to use, I give it slightly higher than SmartThings at 4 out of 5 stars. User experience and UI on the app is not great based on the reviews. The upfront price of this is not cheap either. So for Hubitat, I would not recommend it. I find it too user unfriendly, and looking at the amount of work you put in, the end result is somewhat similar to what you can get with SmartThings. Not officially available in Singapore, which means that you won't be able to get good local support and warranty. If you really want something more powerful than SmartThings, I suggest you to skip Hubitat and jump straight to the last solution I'm covering today, Home Assistant. How powerful is the solution? 5 out of 5 stars. The Home Assistant can almost do anything and everything if you are familiar with scripting and programming because it's a free open source platform. You can integrate with any brands of product, customize the dashboard you want, and customize the functionality of each device to match your needs. The selling point of Home Assistant is everything is set up within your house. It's faster and secured as there's no need to connect to any cloud services. How hard it is to use, I give it 4.5 stars. It's not an off-the-shelf plug-and-play solution. Even for my case, in my professional work, I deal with low-code environment. I foresee myself to have challenges setting this up. But there is a lot of resources online and a huge community to seek help. To get started with Home Assistant, you need to buy a Raspberry Pi or use a virtual machine sitting on a mini PC like the Intel NUC, or simply buy the Home Assistant Blue, which is like a pre-installed hub. If I'm living in a big house, a bungalow or something, I'll definitely look into Home Assistant. The bigger your house is, the more useful you find having a smart home. So for this kind of normal apartment HDB, our smart home setup is not going to be too big and complex. The amount of time and effort to use Home Assistant likely don't justify the benefits you get out of it. Unless you have the interest and passion with smart home, then Home Assistant is for you. I'm happy to say Skillshare has kindly sponsored the video for today. Thanks to all the content creators out there, all this information and knowledge can be easily consumed from the internet. I'm a very visual guy, the best way of learning for me is through videos. So for those who are not aware of what Skillshare is, it is an online learning community with thousands of classes covering all sorts of topics like design, programming, marketing, lifestyle, and even smart home related. Due to our current situation now, since everyone has more time to spare, it's the best time to learn something, pick up some skills during this period. What I like about Skillshare is their charging model where it's subscription-based, something like Netflix. People create videos and courses, put it on Skillshare, then consumers just log in and have access to everything on the platform. Yearly subscription is less than $10 a month. Maybe I should start creating some smart home tutorials, put it on Skillshare and earn some passive income. Alright, the first 1,000 people to use my link in the video description will receive a free trial of the Skillshare Premium. So you will ask, out of these 7 smart home solutions, which is better? That's difficult to answer because it depends on what you're looking for and what kind of person you are. Are you just looking for something very straightforward? Do you have some IT background knowledge? Or you are just a totally tech newbie? So if I were to break down this into 3 levels, easy, intermediate, advanced. For easy, I would recommend Amazon Alexa. Intermediate, Samsung SmartThings. And for advanced will be Home Assistant. The smart home world is going to keep changing and evolving. Personally, I'm sticking to SmartThings for now. Maybe I'll switch to Home Assistant in the future, or maybe to Amazon, lesser device lying around, provided they allow more customization. So hopefully my review of these 7 smart home solutions will help you make a choice of which is more suitable for you. Alright, that's all from me. Hope you enjoyed this video. Thumbs if you like it, and share this with your friends if they are into smart home. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.